The Bundesliga is back, and so am I, finally. After more than 1 year break, the Bundesliga final took place in Berlin and we played the remaining seven rounds. In the first game, I played with the Black Pieces against Andreas Heimann, who plays for Deitzesau. And for me, Deitzesau is the team of the young German players, very strong ones. But apparently some of them are not as young anymore if you look at the birth dates. And some of them are even not as German anymore, so maybe I should update my belief on that. Well, Heimann in any case opened with knight f3. He also plays e4 and d4, I think more regularly even than that, so I was not really expecting knight f3. But apparently after knight f6 c4, he wanted to avoid some parts of my repertoire and probably go into this line with c4, c5, which I had played a couple of times in the Bundesliga, for instance against Almazi, but also in other games with black. So I during the game I thought, okay, this guy's pretty good in theory. I knew that, and so for that reason I went for something else. I just thought, okay, I go for something which is really solid. I play e6, d5, and then we will go for some kind of queen's gambit or Catalan. Well, that's also what happened in the game. So he played g3, bishop g2, so not playing d4 on the spot, which also gives a few extra options for black with d takes c4, which is the move that some people play here to avoid like the mainstream Catalan lines. In any case, I had no problem with playing the normal Catalan, and after d4 castles, I was expecting just castles, and after dc we enter the normal territory of the Catalan. In any case, my opponent had different plans. He went for the line with knight c3. So this has a bit of a more forcing character, especially if black now takes on c4. So in this case, white is not able to capture the pawn back that easily, but you will get a lot of counterplay and compensation by activity in the center, and I also gave up one of my center pawns. So to be honest, I was already out of book after knight c3, and I decided, okay, against such a strong theoretician, I'm not going to go for d takes c, but I just went for the most solid move I could think of, which was the move c6. He castled, and it turns out that this is still theory for quite some time, but I didn't know any of that. But given the fact that my opponent played rather quickly, I imagined that to be the case. So b3, b6, both players make normal developing moves. And right now he plays the move queen to c2, hinting at e4. And there is not really so much I can do against e4. So this is a typical breakthrough in these kind of positions, and the question is always if black can play c5 at the adequate moment. And so for that reason I went rook c8 to prepare c5 to put some pressure on the queen on the c-file later on, and he now went e4 immediately. Because maybe if he doesn't go e4 at this point, then I really go c5 and then I prevent e4. Okay, after e4 I took on e4, forcing him to take back. And now I went for the move c5. I'm now attacking the knight on e4. And so he has the logical move to just take the knight, which releases the pressure. And there is also one more element here. So in these Catalan lines, whenever you take back on f6 with something else than the knight, so let's say the bishop, maybe even in this position immediately white can go for the move bishop g5. So this is always a motive which you should keep in mind if you play the Catalan with black, threatening mate. But at the same time, if I take, he just goes for bishop takes b7, and now he has the pair of bishops and maybe some slight strategic advantage. So for that reason I went knight takes f6. And he again played the logical move rook a d1 rather quickly. And it turns out this is still a game played between Mamedyarov and Vityugov a couple of years ago. So in this position, Vityugov decided to take on d4, which is not the move that I played in the game, but I think this is the more solid and more reasonable move. During the game, I started calculating, and I was not that sure about two different lines. So first of all, bishop takes d4 with maybe some ideas like takes, and there is a discovered attack against the queen. If I go queen c7, maybe he has bishop e5. I think it's not really that bad anyhow. But I was slightly afraid of that, and I even saw some ghosts after c takes d, rook takes d4, queen c7. I thought maybe he can go for something like this. And now knight g5 next move. But it turns out that after h6, black is actually doing fine, because if you're really going all out right now with a move like this, it doesn't work, because I can just take, and after bishop takes f6, threatening mate on h7, I can just take on h4, and there is really not anything anymore in terms of attack. So in any case, I calculated for some time, and then I thought, okay, if I go bishop e4, then at least in the lines after c takes d, bishop, so in the lines which I just showed you, after c takes d and bishop takes, there is often this idea of bishop e5, and if I go bishop e4, I have this square b7 for my queen. So that's the reason why in this position I played bishop e4, but I think this is not a good move. So it's just too early. It's a normal move in these kind of positions, and sometimes even a good one, but not in this exact position. Well, he went for queen e2. Maybe I could still have taken here, but I really didn't like that line anymore, because let's say after takes takes, I now have to give up the pair of bishops, and I don't really have any compensation for it. So I thought white would be better in these positions. Yeah. Instead, after queen e2, I went for queen to c7, logical move, moving out of the d file, and he just took on c5. I think in this position also d5 is interesting. Point is that after takes takes, it's not so easy for me to deal with all these pieces, because if I take now on d5, he can take on f6, so I probably would have played that. And then after some move like rook fe1, it becomes quite concrete, but I think also here white is slightly better. In any case, he went for d takes c, which is also a decent move, and probably now I should have taken back with a bishop, sorry, with a queen, because in this case I can still keep the protection here, so I should have taken back with a queen, and yeah, the position would still be decent, maybe slightly better for white still, but after b takes c, it becomes a bit more problematic even than that. So he now plays in a very simple fashion, but it's pretty strong and pretty unpleasant. So he went for knight e5, and actually after the game he told me that he thought he already had lost some of his advantage here, if there was any, but I'm not so sure. So after takes takes, the square on c6 is really unpleasant. So he will go queen f3 at some point, and then he has a lot of pressure on these squares, and I don't have any bishop anymore to alleviate this pressure on c6. So for that reason, I now thought, okay, I'm just slightly worse. He has this 3-2. My pawn structure is not that great with three pawn islands. So for that reason, I just decided to go for a5 for simplification. Score a5, a4, exchange one pair of pawns. Because even though my position is maybe a bit cramped, it's pretty solid, and I don't have any big weaknesses at the moment. So I don't have the feeling that he has anything very direct. To be honest, here I was expecting the move a4, which looks a bit funny. And I'm also not sure if it's good or not. So on the one hand, white can later potentially generate play against these pawns, especially if all major pieces disappear. Then the structure would be very nice for white, because you can just put pressure on the pawns. But on the other hand, of course, you also create a weakness on b3. So black could go something like rook b8, rook b6, the other rook to b8, and get some counterplay on the b file. So strategically, definitely interesting. The computer actually likes the move which my opponent played better than a4. He played queen f3, which now gives me the chance to play a4. The point being that if he takes, I can just go rook a8, and let's say now if he goes for something like knight c6 or queen c6, I can just go rook fc8 and kick this away again, and then I get a lot of counterplay on the a file. So for that reason, he didn't take, but he just played it very, very slow and simple, just rook d3. Still increasing the pressure with a later rook d1. Okay, I took, which makes a lot of sense. And now I went for the move bishop to d6. So what he wants is to get rook d1. And it's slightly awkward to form an opposition on the d-file. So for instance, if I go rook d8, he can just take. And then the square on c6 is always slightly annoying. Yeah, not sure if even in this line right now, or even maybe exchange one more pair of rooks, and always the c5 in the end is slightly annoying. So it's not so easy for black to deal with that pressure. So I decided to play bishop d6. The main reason for that is that white has to react. So this knight is a very strong piece, but now white has to defend it. And I think the only logical way to do that is the move bishop to rook to e1, defending on e5. And at this point, white's plan is pretty clear. So white wants probably to go just g4, g5 with two more moves. And then black somehow has to be ready to trade down. And maybe I didn't find the most precise way to do that here. So I went for the move rook fe8, g4, h6, logical, create some luft for the king. And now he went for h4. Yeah, and here probably I panicked a little bit with a move bishop takes e5. Instead, the computer gives some interesting moves like rook to d8 and just wait for one more move. So something like this, g5, and now just takes, and I have the move rook takes d3, which I didn't see. And now after takes, I have a check with the queen. So this double attack on these two pieces is not really leading anywhere. So after some move like queen c6 with knight d7 later, black has equalized. Instead, I went for bishop takes e5 immediately, after which white has some pressure with precise play. So he just took back and queen c6. The idea of exchanging queens, which yeah, he just welcomed, took, and played f3. And the position is surprisingly difficult for black. There is still this threat of going g5, but maybe even the threat of going h5, and then with a knight against the bishop later on in an endgame, I will always have some weakness, either h6 or g7. So for that reason, I decided to play a funky looking move, but I think a move which is pretty good. So I played the move h5. The main idea is that if he takes, I take back and he can just take on h5, but this doubled pawn is not going to help him very much, and I think this rook ending is a fairly easy draw. And if he doesn't take, like in the game, king g3, at least I managed to exchange one more pair of pawns, which again decreases his winning chances. So takes. Yeah, and here I made a mistake, according to the computer. So probably I should have played knight to h7 immediately. And yeah, then the position still remains a little bit unpleasant. So for instance, after knight h7, rook d6, I could go something like rook to c8. And yeah, white definitely keeps some pressure. So maybe taking once and rook d1, and then maybe g5 or something. And white has still some kind of an edge. But after what I played in the game, rook a8, he had a quite interesting option. So he didn't see it. He went for the most natural looking move, rook a1. But instead, he could have gone for the move g5 here. So what is the big fuss about it? My logical response to g5 would be knight h7. And this is basically also where I ended my calculation with now f6 next move, and I should be doing fine. However, he has a very concrete way of meeting that, and now we see the problem of this position of the rook and the position of the knight, namely rook to a1, a very strong move. And if I take, then he has this intermediate check on d8, knight f8 and bishop takes a1. Yeah, and now it's not so easy for me to get f6 in anymore. And yeah, my position is definitely worse. So for that reason, rook a1 would have been definitely the best attempt for him in the game to try to win. And yeah, this position is definitely just clearly better for white. G5 followed by rook a1. Instead, he didn't play g5, but he reversed the move order and played rook a1 first. And this is not really that dangerous because now I can just take. And if he goes rook d8 in such a position, I can always go to h7. Yeah, I don't have to have this awkward formation of the pieces on the back rank. I just took back. And I went for a pretty natural plan, the move rook to c7. So my idea is to just trade down more pieces with rook to d7. And that's also what happened in the game. Maybe the last serious chance for him would have been to play g5. But now, in contrast to what we have seen before, I don't have to go to h7, but I can go to d7. And yeah, later on play f6. So maybe to prevent this, he could go h5 immediately and still keep some pressure. I think it's not as much as before, but it's still somewhat unpleasant because going f6 can sometimes be met by g6. Instead of that, he went for bishop to e5, attacking my rook. But after rook d7, this endgame is just fairly easy to hold. And actually, he told me after the game that he misevaluated the endgame and he thought it would not be easy for me to hold that. Because he wanted to get such a position with pawns on g5 and h5, but he will not be able to do that anymore. And we will see why, because just after takes takes, I can now prevent that from happening. So prevent this kind of pawn structure, which would be a bit awkward because whenever I go f6, he has g6, but instead now I play f6 myself. So the last precise move, because now whenever he goes g5, I can just take and it's a fairly easy draw. Yeah, I was even hoping here that he would somehow overpush and maybe I would get some winning chances, but obviously this is only possible if white wants that. So he went for king f4, king f7. Yeah, now this is the first position basically where I'm threatening e5 check followed by king e6. So he basically now restricted that option with playing by playing h5. And yeah, this basically ensures that I don't have any winning chances anymore as well, because I can never go e5 because of king f5 now. And everybody basically just stays pat. I decided to exchange one more pair of pawns with g6. And after h takes g, he offered a draw. So this would still be pretty risky for white, because then I could go for this pawn. So I think it's now time to pull the brake and to take on g6, which he did, and he offered a draw, which I can't really refuse, because after taking, there is not much happening other than maybe kings moving back and forth between e4 and f4 and f7 and g6, and the game will just fizzle out. Well, this was the first game of the tournament, so for me it was nice to make a draw against a player who's a bit more than 100 rating points above me, with the black pieces. He had some chances definitely in the game, and yeah, I'm not that happy with the way I played early on in the game with this bishop e4, but I was quite tenacious in the end, so I think overall it was a decent game. Well, that's it for the first game, and I will be back with the second game from Berlin.
When you have stress, play chess. When you fall on your ass, play chess for a real deal, for Christian Seal.